A debate about the Baha'i faith. The basic problem of authority in the Baha'i faith, with its false claim that those authorities are infallible, really becomes obvious when you consider the issue of the guardianship, which Shaghi Effendi held from 1921 until his death in 1957. He was appointed to that position by his grandfather, Abdul Baha. Later, Shaghi Effendi himself wrote, "Divorced from the institution of the guardianship, the world order of Baha'u'llah would be mutilated and permanently deprived of that hereditary principle which, as Abdul Baha has written, has been invariably upheld by the law of God. Without such an institution, the integrity of the faith would be imperiled, and the stability of the entire fabric would be gravely endangered. Its prestige would suffer, the means required to enable it to take a long and uninterrupted view over a series of generations would be completely lacking, and the necessary guidance to define the sphere of the legislative action of its elected representatives would be totally withdrawn. It stands to reason that, if Shaghi Effendi must be obeyed absolutely as the representative of God's will, then he himself must obey the Baha'i commandments that came before him. If he was disobedient to Baha'i laws, then no one should obey him." Baha'u'llah, the founder of the Baha'i faith, stated in his Book of Laws, the Kitab Aqdas, paragraph 109, "Unto everyone hath been enjoined the writing of a will. Likewise, Abdul Baha, son of Baha'u'llah, in the very will and testament by which he appointed Shaghi Effendi to the guardianship, stated, 'It is incumbent upon the guardian of the cause of God to appoint in his own lifetime him that shall become his successor, that differences may not arise after his passing. He that is appointed must manifest in himself detachment from all worldly things, must be the essence of purity, must show in himself the fear of God, knowledge, wisdom and learning. Thus, should the firstborn of the guardian of the cause of God not manifest in himself the truth of the words, the child is the secret essence of its sire, that is, should he not inherit of the spiritual within him, the guardian of the cause of God, and his glorious lineage not be matched with a goodly character, then must he, the guardian of the cause of God, choose another branch to succeed him." Shaghi Effendi did none of these things. He had no children, and in fact he expelled from the faith as covenant breakers every other descendant of his own grandfather, thus betraying the faith. When he died in 1957, he left no will and had appointed no successor, thus failing to obey the very covenant he was expected to uphold. With no further guidance from the guardian, the hands of the cause of God that he had appointed to assist him did the only thing they could to keep the Baha'i faith alive. They took over the faith and arranged for the eventual election of the Universal House of Justice in 1963. But without a guardian to preside over that body, it would never be in accordance with the very writings that established its authority. And the only ones who could be guardian were the male descendants of Baha'u'llah, all of whom were excluded from the faith by the first guardian. Indeed, the simple fact that Shaghi Effendi disobeyed both Baha'u'llah and Abdul Baha by not leaving a will, by expelling all his own relatives from the faith, and not appointing in his lifetime one of his brothers or male cousins as his successor to the guardianship should be enough to demonstrate that there is no true Baha'i faith existing today. Its authority is meaningless by the testimony of its own history. To all those who are still members of this faith, as I was years ago, I implore you to be fair in your judgment and search your feelings. The Baha'i faith has failed you, and you need not be bound by laws, authorities, or institutions that are not based on truth. Whether you belong to the mainstream Baha'i faith that follows the guardianship-less Universal House of Justice, or one of the splinter groups that rejected the authority of that body, the fact remains you follow a spiritually dead faith and are totally wasting your time. The Baha'i faith will never become the great religion of the world Baha'u'llah and Abdu Single Kotel Baha envisioned it to be, because Shaghi Effendi ruined it with his blind assumption of his own infallibility. His own relatives questioned his decisions and were expelled for doing that. If you cannot question authority, it can destroy you. Or, in this case, the credibility of the authority is destroyed and opposing it becomes a moral obligation. Let it be so. The Baha'i leadership is so riddled with hypocrisy and lies that it has no credibility. If you don't obey your own scriptures, and teach that those scriptures from the past don't matter for reasons, you have no basis for your authoritarian cult. I think I have said enough. So, what is your rebuttal, David Binowan? I am sorry, but I knew you when you were a Baha'i. You should, therefore, know that what you are saying is filled with hate and not at all true. Some of the Baha'is in the two communities you were a member of are some of the most devout and sincere people, just as there are devoted and sincere persons of many religions. If you ever met some of the hands of the cause when they were alive or House of Justice members as I have, you would know how terribly false these accusations really are. You ignore and omit all the evidence Baha'is really have for our faith and resort to emotional name-calling with pejorative terms instead. That is not a discussion or debate, just a diatribe. These kinds of misrepresentations are exactly the same excuses used to harass, falsely arrest, falsely accuse, torture, imprison, and even kill Baha'is in some places. I have served in the past in two major Baha'i cities with hundreds of Baha'is each and lived in two metro areas with thousands of Baha'is, and most that I knew were sincere and practiced our faith sincerely far more than members of other religions practice their religions. Some of the Baha'is I have met, including traveling in Africa in the early 1990s, escaped persecution and suffering in Iran and other parts of the Middle East and Africa, something you seem to not care about. I had friends who had family members killed, homes raided and trashed, family members arrested, and more. Despite the persecution for 40 years in Iran, the vast majority of Baha'is and their children have remained faithful. On a personal note, I have no idea how or why you developed such hatred and intolerance over time. Sociologists and psychologists have tried to study this phenomenon to understand why former members of a religion turn on their religion for irrational reasons. But it is neither healthy, nor correct, nor acceptable. Unlike some Islamic rules, you are free to leave the Baha'i faith, as free as you are to join. No Baha'i can or will threaten you or your life or your property for leaving the faith. All that is asked is that you practice those morals of respect for others, truthfulness, self-sacrifice, and charity that we Baha'is teach and practice and seek to promote. Instead, you have become increasingly more strident and extreme over time and less willing to reason and consider the evidence, and there is extensive evidence and arguments for our faith. Otherwise, so many devout believers over the years, including academics and religious scholars and clerics, would not have become Baha'is. Anyone who posts where you post encounters false information, even if not a Baha'i, is insulted, shouted down, and falsely accused even if not a Baha'i. And you and your associates complain about their comments and replies and demand that they be banned on some forums. Baha'is, by contrast, while permitted to defend our faith, cannot resort to hatred or intolerance. Most Baha'is avoid these forums and debates because we are told to avoid conflict and contention. We are also told to defend and present our faith. You and your associates attacked me repeatedly, so you invited me to respond. We may avoid associating with those trying to violate the Baha'i covenant, which are relatively few, but even then always love our enemies, and avoid the kinds of tactics and hatred and hypocrisy you exemplify both in your posts on Reddit and on your blog, which you promote but should be embarrassed by some things you say and do. It is almost like choosing to turn from being a Baha'i. You decided to violate the most basic rules of Baha'i behavior such as truthfulness, forgiveness, tolerance, love, and open-mindedness. I was 12 years old in 1973 when, due to an accident, thrown from a horse, I had an extended surgery on my arm and an extended near-death experience due to an issue with anesthesia and shock. I was a devout, but liberal and academic Christian and loved and still love the church I grew up in, so this was all a shock to me. There was no literature at that time about near-death experiences, but I wrote down some of what I had experienced and been told about God and religion. My experience was 29 out of 32 on the Grayson scale. Not only did I review my relatively short life and experience the judgment we all will experience upon death, but I was shown bits and pieces and told things about my future. I was told Christ had returned, his religion was in the Holy Land, and I would find this religion. I was told the major teachings of this religion. During my search, I read the Quran and recognized that Prophet Muhammad must be a messenger of God, even with all the disinformation about Islam in the United States. After almost 6 years of searching, and almost giving up in despair more than once, I stumbled upon a book called Baha'u'llah and the New Era and realized everything I had been told was true. I spent 3 months in a summer reading every book I could find and then meeting with Baha'is occasionally to ask questions. Then and only then did I decide to leave the church I grew up in and inform my parents of my decision. Now, my parents are glad for my faith and profoundly respect it. They even traveled with my wife and me to Israel in 2016 to view holy sites of Judaism, Christianity, Islam, and Baha'i. Every time you falsely attack me or the Baha'i faith, think about my experience and if what I was told might be true. After all, there is now an extensive literature confirming these types of near-death experiences by respected medical doctors, neurologists, and psychologists. How the hell does any of that long-winded rant answer properly anything I said about your faith? So if you want to understand why debating with Baha'is is useless, now you can see exactly why.